Hello, are you keeping well? I have on my channel a list of videos with the title History of Ideas, where I have put philosophical videos, and there are many of my videos about the ideology of Karl Marx, some of Hegel as well. And I would like very much to continue this list. I plan in this video to read to you what Kolakowski has written about the resume he has given of the philosophy of egocentrism of Max Stirner. And then we can discuss it.
Stirner and the philosophy of egocentrism. Max Stirner, 1806-1856, real name Johann Caspar Schmidt. His book The Ego and His Own, 1844. Stirner's book is a proclamation of absolute egoism, a philosophical affirmation of the ego, capital E, considered not as a distinct individual, body or soul, but as pure consciousness, an ego in which existence and the awareness of existence are identical. Stirner's apologia for the uniqueness of personality is an extreme reaction to Hegel's reduction of individuals to the role of instruments of the universal idea. But it also stands in opposition to Feuerbach's cult of humanity as a species, to Christianity, which subordinates mankind to values imposed by God, to liberalism, with its democratic faith in the common nature of man, to socialism, and to some extent even to Marx, whom Stirner once quotes as the author of Introduction to a Critique of Hegel's Philosophy of Right. Stirner maintains that the whole effort of philosophy has been, in one way or another, to subject the authentic human individual to some form of impersonal general being. Hegel deprived human individuals of reality by treating them as manifestations of universal spirit. Feuerbach liberated man from religious alienation only to replace the tyranny of God by that of the species, man in his universal aspect. As Feuerbach opposed species man to God, so Stirner sets up against man the irreducible ego, uniquely and solely present to itself in each particular case. All religions, philosophies, and political doctrines require me to fix my attention on outside things, God, man, society, the state, humanity, truth, and never simply on myself. Yet my self is all that matters to me, and it requires no justification precisely because it is mine. Hence Stirner adopted as his motto the line from Goethe, "I have put my trust in nothing." The ego is not describable in words that are used to describe other things. It is absolutely irreducible, the self-sufficient plenitude of subjectivity, a perfect self-contained universe. In affirming my ego, I am simply myself. It is for me the only reality and the only value. My ego is sovereign. It recognizes no authority or constraint such as humanity, truth, the state, or any other impersonal abstraction. All general values are foreign to myself and do not concern me. From this point of view, the differences between moral or philosophical doctrines are insignificant. Christianity condemned self-love, egoism, and self-indulgence. So does liberalism, although on a different principle. And the result is the same. The idea of equality is no less destructive of the sovereign ego than is the despotism of God. By reducing individuals to the level at which they share equally in the impersonal nature of humanity, I am circumscribing human personality and destroying it by turning it into a mere instance of a species. Socialism does the same when it seeks to reduce the unique ego to the anonymity of social being, subordinating its own values to those of the community. From the fundamental standpoint of the emancipation of the ego, it is much the same whether I am enslaved to impersonal Hegelian reason or to humanity, to divine being or to the mass of my fellow creatures. All these purport to reduce subjective human existence to some kind of universal essence and to resolve the conflict between the thinking subject and society by destroying the former. The true way to put an end to human alienation is to abolish whatever subjects the ego to universal impersonal values. Stirner's philosophy is thus an affirmation of total egoism and egocentrism, in which the whole universe is only taken into account as a means to the realization of the individual's private values. Is any community life possible on this basis? Yes, said Stirner, but the relations between individuals must be personal, i.e. not mediated by society or by institutions, and free from reified forms. The proper business of education, accordingly, is not to train people to render services to society. The kind of education which seeks to make good citizens, as in liberal doctrine, is an enslavement of the ego, a triumph of generality over true existence. From this point of view, liberalism is a continuation of Christianity, and communism of liberalism. The human individual is alienated, according to Stirner, whenever he is subjected to anything outside himself, including goodness or truth, considered as values binding on everyone. There is no general good and no moral law that can be imposed on me as a duty. Even the rules of logic are a tyranny over my unique existence. Language itself is a threat, being a reification of life. It is hard to see, indeed, how Stirner's program of total egoism can be realized in practice. The whole of civilization, in his view, is a system of manifold pressure on the ego, and a man's self-affirmation involves rejecting the mores and the scientific and cultural achievements of the community, which are all instruments of servitude as far as he is concerned. Apparently, therefore, a return from alienation to authenticity would mean the denial of civilization and a return to animality and the unbridled sway of individual passions. Since specifically human behavior is the outcome of a collective civilization, the wholesale rejection of the norms of that civilization must mean a regression to a pre-human state. Stirner does not spell out this conclusion, but merely speaks of the ego's need to rebel against enslavement. This it does, not by endeavoring to alter external conditions in any way, but by the emancipation of its personal self-consciousness independently of the outside world. My act of rebellion is a self-affirmation in which I oppose my ego to every form of generality. It neither expects nor requires any external success. In brackets, Raskolnikov in Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment may be taken as an embodiment of the ego as conceived by Stirner. Close the brackets. The theory thus implies that in the last resort, the source of each man's servitude lies within him. He is fettered by his own false imagination and deference to universals, and can accordingly liberate himself by a purely spiritual act. In Stirner's system, the ego is always unique. This means not only that it possesses qualities peculiar to itself and to be found nowhere else, but it is actually inexpressible in words. Its specific, irreducible subjectivity cannot be defined or conceptually understood, since language consists of signs denoting what is common to two or more objects. Subjectivity is beyond the reach of human utterance. The life of the ego consists of recognizing oneself and one's thoughts simply as one's own and not as impersonal general truths. Man becomes exclusively himself, self-rooted and self-justified. Not an individual in a community, but an ego living its own life. The ego's values are in complete opposition to such universal notions as law or the public good. My freedom is an enemy to the general freedom. My ego apprehends itself as a negation of the rest of the universe. The ego's desires or whims are its own law. It is not bound by any state ordinances or rights of man. It seeks no justification from society and acknowledges no obligation towards it. It has a right to everything it can lay hands on. If a criminal can get away with his crime, he is in the right as far as he is concerned. If he is punished, he has no call to blame anyone. What happens is proper in either case. Crime is a politico-legal notion expressing the viewpoint of the generality. But the real crime is to violate the ego. For the egoist in Stirner's sense, community life is worthwhile insofar as it increases his own strength. A community of egoists is conceivable, but it is not a stable polity founded on institutions merely a constant process of uniting and disuniting. The ego refuses to be measured by the yardsticks of humanity. It asserts its own uniqueness and recognizes nothing outside itself, not even thought. My own thoughts are myself, and acknowledge no master, no standard to which they must conform. In a community or assembly of egoists, there are no ties between any man and his fellows, and hence no conflicts, since a conflict is itself a kind of tie. Stirner's work represents a final breach between young Hegelianism and the doctrine of Hegel himself. The criticism of Hegel is pushed to absurd lengths by the condemnation of human society and culture in the name of the monadic sovereignty of the subject. In his violent attacks on Hegel, Stirner invokes a theme that we also find in Marx, the protest against reducing individual human beings to instruments of the absolute, capital A. But they apply this protest in quite different ways. Marx too denies that there is such a thing as humanity over and above individuals, but he regards individuality as the product of civilization. To Stirner, on the other hand, individuality is the same thing as experience of subjectivity. To exist is no more or less than to be aware that one exists. At the same time, his philosophy is an attack on the value of all ties among human beings and the whole historical process of collective development. As recent studies by Helms have shown, Stirner's doctrine inspired not only anarchists but various German groups who were the immediate precursors of fascism. At first sight, Nazi totalitarianism may seem the opposite of Stirner's radical individualism, but fascism was above all an attempt to dissolve the social ties created by history and replace them by artificial bonds among individuals who were expected to render implicit obedience to the state on grounds of absolute egoism. Fascist education combined the tenets of asocial egoism and unquestioning conformism, the latter being the means by which the individual secured his own niche in the system. Stirner's philosophy has nothing to say against conformism. It only objects to the ego being subordinated to any higher principle. The egoist is free to adjust to the world if it appears that he will better himself by doing so. His rebellion may take the form of utter servility if it will further his interest. What he must not do is to be bound by general values or myths of humanity. The totalitarian ideal of a barrack-like society from which all real historical ties have been eliminated is perfectly consistent with Stirner's principles. The egoist, by his very nature, must be prepared to fight under any flag that suits his convenience.
Bye!